Das war die Schickmessung, das ist die letzte Folge. So the first part of the question, we calculate the unrevised estimate for the mean and the means. Sample size is 200. And sigma x value is this, and this is sigma x squared. So we know that the unbiased estimate, we know that the unbiased estimate for the population mean is the sample mean, right? And how do we get the sample mean? That would be sigma fx upon sigma f. What is sigma? Oh, no, just sigma x upon sigma. Yeah, we don't have it. Sigma x upon n. So what's sigma x? 35050. And n is 200. Sample size is 200.
175.25.
175.25. Are you all okay with this? Same way, can we get the unbiased estimate for the variance? So we know the unbiased estimate for the variance would be n over n minus 1 times the sample variance. And that would be 200 over 199 times the sample variance. The sample variance is sigma x squared upon n minus mean squared. And that would be 6.63109. Over n minus mean square. Check what's the value. And then 103.5. Is it the exact value?
Yes.
Okay, 103.5. Are you sure it's the exact value?
Yes.
So we got the unbiased estimates for the mean and the variance.
So you always have to multiply with n upon n
yes.
minus 1.
Because you cannot use the sample variance value directly. It is not. The sample variance directly is not an unbiased estimate. You have to use this correction factor to make it into an unbiased estimate. If you're replacing the sigma squared. Sigma squared.
But sir, the question we did before that, in that I think you didn't do this in one.
No, we did this. Yeah. We did this. We did this. We cannot use a sample variance directly. Okay, determine an approximate 90% confidence interval for the mean height of men living in the UK. Name the theorem that you have assumed. Okay, so are we assuming a theorem here? Okay, now we learn how to make a confident interval using a normal distribution. But when do we use a normal distribution on samples? When our population is also normally distributed. Is there any mention of the population being normally distributed in this question? No, there is no mention of that. So we are not sure whether the population is normally distributed or not. We are not sure. It doesn't say anything, the question doesn't say anything. That is why, if you notice, they have given you a very large sample. A sample of 200. So if you remember, we discussed according to the central limit theorem, if the sample size is large, then we need not worry about the nature of the population. The sample mean will follow a normal distribution approximately. And the approximation gets better and better as the sample gets larger and larger. This is a very large sample size. We can very easily use the normal approximation here. So we'll use the normal distribution. So the question is asking, name the theorem that you assume. We have assumed, we are using the central limit theorem. We are making our calculations in accordance with the central limit theorem. Are we good? Okay, for a 90% confidence interval. So a 90% confidence interval would look something like this, based on the normal distribution curve. You have the sample mean right in the middle, which is how much is sample mean? 175.25. and there will be two values around it, symmetrically placed two values around the mean that would accommodate 90% of the distribution, which means this middle area is going to be 0.9. We require 90% confidence interval. So if the middle area is 0.9,
or 0.5,
that means you have 5% area on either sides, which means this is 0.05 and this is also 0.05, which means the area from this point to the extreme end is 0.95. Now in the table you will search for 0.95 and get the z value out. Please don't make this mistake of getting the z value for 0.9. The table requires the area from that point till the extreme end. So you need to give that area to the table to provide you with the correct z value. So the area that you will search for the table is 0.95. Are we all okay with that? So let's check the table. So 0.95 and all these famous values you'll get right here. Right here. Yes, you can all see that z value for 0.94 is 1.645. Okay, so the z value here is 1.645 and same as the z value here is minus 1.645. Let's convert the 1.645 into the x value. So we know the confidence limits are basically x bar plus minus z sigma 1 square root of a. X bar is 175.25 plus minus, we already have the unbiased exponent, which is 103.5, this is the variance. This is a square root basically. So it's 103.5 upon, what's the n value? 200 square.
The limits are 174.07 and 176.5.
So we can say that mu is in between, what are the limits? Low limit is?
174.07.
174.1 and the other one?
176.43.
176.1. That's good enough. That's an interval. What was this, by the way? This was
eigencentimeters.
Yeah. Now please let's write an explanation at the end as well, a conclusion. The question might ask you for a conclusion at the end or an explanation.
103.5 from the square root
of n. That was the variance, not the standard deviation. This is standard deviation upon square root of n. You can think of this is the same as saying variance is the same as saying variance upon n whole root. When I woke up, I took, because I had the variance value with me, so I did that.
So what about the z value?
Oh, I forgot to write. Not sure I want to multiply.
I
didn't. Okay. Forgot to write this, sorry. This is 1. What was the x bar value?
175.25.
Okay, plus minus z value.
1.645.
Yeah. Did you multiply?
Yeah.
Okay. Are we all good? Now please, can you state the conclusion?
We're 90% confident that the mean value of all
distributions will be the
case between
1.7. Yes. We are 90% confident. Exactly. We are 90% confident. Your statement should start with, we are 90% confident that the mean height of men living in the UK, take the wordings from the question. We are 90% confident that the mean height of men living in the UK is between 174.1 and 176.4 centimeters. Are we good? Any questions? At the back, are we good? Okay. Let's move on. Question 4. Results obtained from a random sample of 100 men. Sample size is 100. 95% confidence interval is already given to you. So we'd say the confidence interval is this. So the confidence, okay, it's already here. You can state like this if you want. 77.22. And 97.18. Find the value of sample mean. How do you get the value of sample mean? It's a one line calculation.
And then don't look at deficiency
by? Yes, why? Yes, because the sample mean is right in the middle of the confidence interval. The sample mean is right in the middle of the confidence interval. On the basis of that, we produce our confidence interval on either side. So the sample mean has to be right in the middle. So yes, the sample mean is the midpoint of these two.
178.2.
That's the sample mean. Now can you find the value of sigma? Now to find the value of sigma, you can take any one of the confidence limits. Like I can say, for part B, I can say that the upper limit 179.18, let's say, is formed by taking x bar plus z sigma upon square root of it. Right? So 179.18 equals x bar is 170.2. Plus z, okay, we'll have to get the z value. We'll have to get the z value for a 95% confidence interval. So 95% confidence interval means, yes, we've done this before. The middle area is 0.95, but the z value for this one, I will have to check the area from this point till the extreme end, and you know this is 0.025 and this is also 0.025. So the area is 0.975. Right? That's what we're checking.
Yes.
Let's check in the table for 0.975 and the z value is 1.96. So the z value that we will use here is 1.96 times sigma upon square root of n. Which is?
200.
It's
around
5. Okay, a symmetric 90% confidence interval. So for a 90% confidence interval, 16 is 0.95 because this area is 0.05. So we check on the table for a 0.95 and we just did the question 1.645. So this value is 1.645. So all these limits are going to be plus minus the sigma of the square of n. The idea is that, and I think we did have this discussion earlier on, that if you want to be more confident, you will have to widen your interval. And the shorter, the thinner your interval, the less confident you would be. So the width of the interval is 2z sigma of square root n. If z value becomes large, automatically the width becomes more. Right? And more z value means more confidence. Bigger area. And there's another way of increasing the confidence. Okay, there's another way of shortening your interval but being the same, having the same level of confidence. How would you want to do that? See, you can easily widen the interval, you'll become more confident. You shorten the interval, you'll be less confident. But let's say I'm in a situation, but I want to have the same level of confidence. But I want to reduce my interval.
Increase the sample size.
Increase the sample size. If you increase the sample size for the same given z value, because see the z value depends on the confidence level. If I keep the same z value and I increase the sample size, my width of the interval is going to go down. Which means my with the same confidence, I can give a better, more precise interval. And that's why I have been repeatedly saying since the start of the chapter of sampling, that the bigger the sample size, the better representation it is of the population. And the lesser errors we expect to have in our calculations. So I can have the same level of confidence even for a shorter interval if I increase my sample size. Clearly. So let's have a look at question 5. And by the way, this width of the confidence interval, it's not a derived formula. See, you write here in the middle with x bar, and to reach the upper limit, you do plus z times sigma of the square of n. So this spacing from x bar to the upper limit, this space is z sigma of the square of n. The same space is on the left as well. So I want to find the width of the interval, which is from the lower end to the upper end. Is it not 2 times z sigma root square of n, because this length is also z sigma root square of n and this length is also z sigma root square of n. So the total width from the lower limit to the upper limit is 2 times z sigma root square of n. Can you all see that? That's why the interval over here is 2 z sigma root square of n. Are we good? Let's do question 5. Thank you. standard deviation has already given to you 1.3, and the confidence interval is based on 95% confidence level. Okay, the width of the interval is mentioned. 2. Level of confidence is 0.95, and width confidence interval width is 2.
Less than 2.
So the width is less than 2. Which means that 2z sigma 1 square of n should be less than 2. Can you find out the least number of tests that should be carried out? That means the value of n. So for a 95% symmetric, z value is
1.96.
We just used it in a few questions.
1.96.
Okay, so 1.96. Sigma is 1.3. On square of n less than 2. Can you work out? Can you work this out for the value of n? You must be getting n greater than something.
N is greater than 6.5.
Guys, check. Are we getting n greater than 6.5?
Sir, you've taken out the z value for 0.95.
Yes. No, 0.95 confidence level. So, when you have the 95% confidence level.
But shouldn't you take out the z value for.
Yes, again. We just did this for question 4. A 95% confidence level means the probability is 0.975, and the z value is 1.96 for that. Yeah, we used it. Yeah. Is it n greater than 6.5?
Yes.
Okay, so therefore the least value I'm required is 7. N has to be greater than 6.5. Coming down to proportions, just a few questions on proportions, then we come to this chapter. Okay, so up till now, we were only bothered with finding a confident interval for the population mean. So the idea was that we didn't have the population mean with us, so we took the sample mean and then we formed an interval around it just to have an idea within what values would the actual population mean fall. Just to have an interval within which the actual population mean would fall. Now we are interested in not the population mean, but we are interested in the values of proportions. So if you read question number 6, you'll understand what I'm trying to say. So a manufacturer wants to assess the proportion of defective items. He's not talking about the average number of defective items. He's talking about the proportion of defective items in a large batch. So produced by a particular machine, he tests a random sample of 300 items and finds that 45 items are defective. Now see, this is where the concept of proportion comes in. He took a sample of 300. And he found out that in a sample of 300, his defective items were 45, which means that the proportion of defective items is 45 over 300. 0.1. Are you good? Okay. Now, we are interested in forming a confidence interval based on the proportion. See, he has only looked at 300 items and he is just making a guess. He only looked at 300 items and he found 45 defective, which means around 15% of the items are defective. But does that mean that in the entire population, in his entire inventory, 15% items are defective? Might not be, maybe a little more than 15% are defective, maybe a little less than. So just based on the sample proportion value, he wants to build an interval, a confidence interval, and then give a range that if not exactly 15%, then around this percentage of defective items will be present in the entire batch. So he wants to make a 95% confidence interval. Now, let's just go back. The idea comes from the fact that a proportion is like a probability of success. A proportion is just another, this proportion, this sample proportion that you're looking at, 45 items out of 300, is like, and there's another way of looking at it is that it's the probability of success or the probability of finding an effective item in a large batch, 0.15. So this proportion distribution, this distribution of proportion basically is a binomial distribution. And you know that if in a binomial distribution, the number of trials, 300, by the way, 300 items he chose, if I look at it with a binomial perspective, the 300 items is basically the 300 number of trials in which he found 45 defective items. So his probability of success is basically 0.15. So if the sample size is large enough in a binomial, large enough for NP and NQ both to be greater than 5, if you remember, we did this in S1, we can approximate a binomial distribution to a normal distribution. And that's exactly what we're going to do now. We will still build a confidence interval based on the normal distribution, but we will approximate the binomial to a normal distribution. This is what we're going to do. So in all these questions, you will notice that the sample size is going to be large enough for NP and NQ both to be greater than 1. So once we are using the normal distribution, then this is the confidence interval that you will calculate. Let me just put this here. This is how you would go about calculating the confidence interval. Your population proportion will be in between these two values. These are the two limits. This is the lower limit, confidence limit. This is the upper confidence limit. The only difference is in place of X bar, you have a sample proportion. You had an X bar over here, you have a sample proportion. Same Z is right there. And then in place of sigma upon square root of N, you have P times Q upon N whole root. This is how you calculate the standard deviation for a proportion. So what values do we have with us? These are the values we have with us. This is the sample proportion 0.15, ES value. 95%, for a 95% confidence interval, what's the Z value?
1.196,
right? So now let's say the actual proportion of defective items in the large batch, in the entire inventory level, is between these two values, and this on the right side it would be 0.15 plus 1.96 square root of 0.15 times 0.85 upon 300. And on the left, same thing on the left, but with the minus sign. So, what's our interval coming out to be?
The lower limit is 0.11 and the upper limit is 0.15.
The
1 1 1.
It's 10959.
10959. 110. Okay, and then the other one?
0.1.
1? 9 0. 190. Okay. I just want to increase 3 meters. That's the population proportion interval that we get. Explain the confident interval. Again, the statement is going to start the same way. We are 95% confident. We are 95% confident that the proportion of defective items in the large batch produced by the particular machine is between 0.11 and 0.190. We are 95% confident that the proportion of defective items in a large batch produced by a particular machine is between 0.11 and 0.19. Take the wording from the question. Okay, let's see who can come with the answer for part C, and I'm just going to give you a hint that it is, the calculation is only this much. It's not even 1 line. So let's see who can give me the answer to part C. This big, literally not even 1 line.
It's not
true. The answer is 190.
The answer is?
190. Okay. It's 95% of 200.
Oh, 95% of.
See, try to understand what he's trying to say. He's saying this is one test that you've done. He did 200 tests like these, and every test was based on 95% confidence level. If I ask you for this test, what are the chances that the actual proportion will fall in this interval? What are the chances? 95%. Because you look at 95% confidence level, that's what the 95% confidence level means. That there is a 95% chance of the actual proportion falling within this interval. So if I am taking 200 such tests and all of them are based on 95%, how many of those tests would have the actual proportion falling within the interval? 95% of the number of tests, 95% of 200, 190. The probability is the same for each test. It's an equal likely outcome case. So 95% means 95 out of 100 are going to have it, so out of 200 is going to be 190. Right?